You are now listening to the House by the Video Store podcast.
Welcome to the House by the Video Store bonus podcast. I'm your host, William, and joining me today will be Sean.
Hello.
And we'll be discussing the fifth episode of the X-Files Season 10, Babylon. And one of the episodes that features one of the most surreal sequences they've had in this revival of the series so far. And it introduces a baby Mulder and Scully that kind of mirror those characters' beliefs and traits, even if it's stretching credulity to believe that the FBI would have another set of agents that are kind of a dark-haired white dude and a red-haired white chick who both share belief of the paranormal and then skepticism with the female having a doctor's background. But this is, like we said, it's the fifth episode, so there's only one more. And I will say I've enjoyed some of these kind of one-off stories, but ultimately I think this season would have been better helped if they had had some of the mythology arc running through the entire thing, or at least through more of the episodes. Because as it is, there's only two episodes that actually focused on kind of the mythology, you know, alien paranoia backstories.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think that if you kind of look at the course of the series, a lot of people have hated the comedic episodes, because I always loved the ones like Jose Chung's Outer Space or Humbug or Bad Blood, but a lot of people didn't like those. And I think that, you know, in this one, the Mulder and Scully meet the Weremonster was kind of good to have at the halfway point of the season, kind of, you know, kind of deconstruct the show and break tension a little bit and be kind of a good reset for more serious stories. But then to have it followed up with a, you know, literal Monster of the Week story in last week's episode, Home Again, and then to this one be kind of essentially the entire X-File in this is them trying to talk with a man who's close to death.
Yeah.
Which you wouldn't think the FBI
would. And they wrap it up in a terrorist storyline.
Yeah, it's
like, I've seen a little bit of flack here recently about the Islamophobe.
Yeah, yeah, I mean,
of the episode.
So, like, you know, and all these things, we're talking full spoilers. Just the general idea is that it opens on a young man who's praying to Allah, and then him and another man go to a public location and it explodes. And they're trying to determine what the reason that occurred for was and who's responsible. And Mulder and Scully get brought in. And then there's the younger agents, Miller and Einstein, who are working on the case. They're kind of mirror images of them from earlier in their careers. And that's kind of the entire setup. And the like I said, I kind of wish that they had had, you know, at least, I think that like 3 and 3 would have been a good split for this. 3 episodes that are kind of standalone and 3 that are mythology arc. Essentially, since the mythology stuff, the first episode of this, you know, episode 10 or series 10, like the first episode of it kind of said, hey, everything from the original series, that's not true.
Yeah, and then they left that hanging since then.
Yeah, and like the more I thought about it, it's like when you go back, so does that mean that everything is in the original run of the series, a lot of the episodes came from the point of view of the conspirators and showed you stuff, so it's like, was that not true? Or was there, you know, even more going on behind the fact, or, you know, is it just retconning it now? But, you know, kind of looking beyond that, this episode had, like, so Mulder and Scully Meet the Weremonster was, you know, very purposefully humorous. And this one had a sequence that was very trippy, where Mulder was either taking acid or a sugar pill.
Placebo, yeah.
Placebo. So he was either actually taking it or he just made himself think he took it. And I never thought, out of all the stuff that would happen in the 6-episode run, that they would find a way to fit in Achy Breaky Heart.
I was thinking that too watching that. I was like, I did not expect this to happen at the beginning of this episode dealing with terrorism.
going to Achy Breaky Heart.
Yeah,
and line
him line dancing in Texas. But And I was also hoping kind of at the beginning when the building explodes, like it kind of goes in there seeming like that's what you know, I don't want to say it seems like that's what was going to happen, but they were obviously trying to put that in your mind, you know, because they were praying together. But I thought, well, maybe they're praying together. And I kind of expected that explosion to happen because we've seen that before, those long takes and the explosion is supposed to shock you.
Yeah.
But it kind of went out a little bit. It kind of gave itself away, I think. And it was a great sequence when everybody's like walking out on fire and everything. Yeah. Not to make light of terrorism, of course, but I mean, it was an excellently done sequence. It just kind of gave itself away. And I was hoping the twist would be that they were simply there for whatever reason. And, you know, maybe the blame was going to be pinned on them or whatever. But that was not the case. It was kind of as you expected it to be.
And I was almost expecting it to be kind of a twist, like they were a couple or something based on some of the kind of like the way that the one character was in, like waiting for the other guy to get there in the beginning sequences, mm-hmm. like the kind of tension that was there.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, so is this like a reversal? It's like, oh, you think that they're Islamic terrorists, but they're really just concerned about their relationship or something. It's like, no, they didn't go that direction.
That's what I was hoping, there would be some sort of reversal. So it's getting a little bit of backlash because of that stuff too, which I can see why. I can understand why people would be sensitive to that. For me, overall watching it, I feel like it was pretty well paced. Like there was some lulls where they kind of talk about some, I guess, existential things or whatever. And it's, I don't want to say it's preachy because it's not really trying to sell you on anything. It's just a lot of talking about their ideologies, you know,
yeah.
Like Mulder and everything. So that stuff was a little bit long winded, but for the most part, I feel like it was structured pretty well. And I was kind of invested in this episode and wondering what was going to happen around every turn. And I kind of loved the trip out sequence. Like it wasn't perfect, but I just loved how crazy it was. You know, I was like, okay, that's cool. Like I have loved the variety of the episodes, even though there are like kind of monsters of the week. One thing I do like about this is it really does feel like each writer has been like given the, there haven't been beholden to maybe, what Chris Carter or anybody else has kind of made them say, hey, it has to be this thing. It's almost like they even get to their own interpretation of the characters as well, like what they want Mulder and Scully to be, especially this. Like this felt very much like, you know, they had possibly a more intimate relationship than some of the other ones. Before, it's like, yeah, they had a past, but they're still, and they care about each other, but, you know, they're still partners. Like this, especially the end of the episode, it felt very intimate. And I like that aspect of it.
Yeah, I mean, it almost felt like there was a Mulder and Scully rom-com in the middle of this episode.
Yes, yeah. There was a lot of things going on in this episode, and I think that's why I liked it. It kind of, there was a lot of shifts in tone and everything, and some of it was pretty funny, actually.
It made sure, like, so at the end segment with, like, Mulder and Scully, kind of like the relationship part, it made sure to use the Lumineers Hey Ho, which was the, like, almost, I think, number one song that I saw in romantic comedy trailers or commercials for, like, two years.
Yeah, I was thinking that song's a little dated by now, and it was super overused, but whatever, you know.
But back to kind of, like, the overall arc of the story, so the Islamic terrorist angle, there really wasn't any nuanced commentary on terrorism or its perception. There was just simply white characters, whether they be the nurse or members of, you know, other members of law enforcement or the government, who were just, you know, anti-terrorist and are saying racist or, you know, Islamophobic or kind of xenophobic things. Because there's like a little rant that one of the characters went on about immigrants. I was like, there's just people saying things, but the episode itself didn't really layer any nuanced views of that in.
Yeah, it was almost just like a plot device instead of taking the opportunity to, you know, as you said, kind of comment on it. And you thought it may go down the direction. You know, especially now that I'm thinking, the scene in the beginning when one of the, you know, the guy that ends up being in the hospital, the terrorist, when he's in the car and they like those like rednecks are yelling at him or whatever, you know, and you kind of feel sympathy for him a little bit, but they don't do anything. I thought that they were going to use that to like turn things on your head or, you know, subvert expectations, but they don't.
Yeah, they just kind of do the straightforward story that would have made sense on 24 back during its original run.
Yeah. Well, and you think if there's any like rednecks watching that, they're like, yeah, damn straight, you know.
What? They just proved us right.
Like, it was totally justified in saying that to him or whatever, you know. But yeah, so that part was disappointing. But I did, you know, you're speaking about the nurse who she goes to kill him. You know, basically she has the chance because she's alone and she cuts off his oxygen, I believe. At least that's what it appeared to be.
Or she just turn off the life support devices, whatever yes. They were doing.
Yeah. Yeah, so she turns that off and then was it Einstein and Mulder that come in and she starts ranting and Einstein, you know, she talks about taking our jobs and blah, blah, blah. And Einstein's just like, yeah, we're not going to solve that right now, which is totally great, you know, because people rant about that so much. And it's like, yeah, well, I mean, I get your concern, but sometimes maybe your short-term solutions won't solve the problem. And they don't do anything to help the issue, you know?
Yeah.
And her killing him would not have helped, you know,
anything.
Any of her complaints, really. It would have just made her feel better about getting her, you know, anger out in a certain way.
Until the it was found out that she caused it, and then one of the most racially and politically charged trials of the past 10 years starts when she's on trial. So what did you think about Miller and Einstein, the kind of baby Scully and Mulder that showed up in this episode?
Miller felt a bit vanilla for me. I thought it was, again, I thought that was like fun that they were, you know, granted it's not realistic, but it's like it was just an interesting element that they threw in that they could I feel like they did explore a few things with those characters. I mean, not a lot, but Miller, he felt a little vanilla for me, you know. If that rumor, or not a rumor, but, you know, as you mentioned, speculation about, oh, a spinoff series with these guys, he feels a little vanilla and he's not doing it for me as far as, he wasn't bad by any means, but Einstein, I actually kind of liked her a lot.
Yeah, I mean, I think that she played well with Mulder. Mm-hmm. And yeah. Like with Miller, towards the end of the episode, he's listening to headphones by himself. I'm like, is this almost a scene like where it shows that he's like a double agent or reporting to somebody else or evil? But it was just like, no, it was just the way they framed
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
But, you know, I thought that, like you said, so Miller was a little bit just kind of where they cast like hunky white dude with dark hair.
Yes.
And
yeah. Such a hunk.
And, and then with Einstein, it was more of, you know, she, like, her character was more fleshed out, but it's also because, like, the rapport between her and Mulder was a little bit more playful.
Yes. So,
and, you know, she was included in, like, his vision trip and kind of more central to the episode as opposed to, you know, Scully and Miller just kind of, they were less in the thick of things because they weren't involved in the acid trip.
Mm-hmm.
And
to the, you know, you're speaking about the acid trip and the bondage scene. So when he pulls down his shirt, that's showing his marks from the bondage scene, right? Is that what that is?
I think so.
Yeah, that's what I assumed it was.
But and then that trippy sequence also shows a, you know, brief cameo by the Lone Gunman. Mm-hmm. And when the series, before it started, they had mentioned that the cigarette smoking man was back and the Lone Gunman. It's like, so are they going to retcon all this stuff and show these people are still alive? With the cigarette smoking man, he is still alive.
Yeah.
In the actual real world, as opposed to having him blown up like a helicopter in the original series finale. And the Lone Gunman died in season 9. So I was curious.
And the cigarette smoking man was also in this dream sequence, right? Wasn't
yeah.
he in the...
Yes.
But he didn't have his trach
yeah,
smoking tube or whatever.
Yeah, he wasn't as scarred up and injured. It's probably just so the actor actually doesn't have to have all the makeup and prosthetic mm-hmm. stuff on. But yeah. It also had Skinner in it for a brief moment. But I was curious to see what they're going to do with the Lone Gunman. And as of right now, it appears they are still dead. So they haven't rewritten that. Although they had the comics for the X-Files, like the season 10 and 11 comics, that had kind of retconned it and said that the Lone Gunman had survived and were alive. So they haven't worked that into the show yet. And if that's the only glimpse of them that we get to see, some people may be disappointed because they were fan favorite characters. But it was fun to see them back, even if they were in cowboy attire in a trip sequence. But the kind of resolution to the episode, as Mulder realizes and remembers what the guy had said in his vision. And they use that information to find where the rest of that cell is before they can do any more damage. Kind of tied things up. This is one of the few episodes where the agents actually, through their own actions, resolve the case definitively.
Yeah.
Because a few of them, like the Weremonster, Scully figures out who the killer is. And then Mulder's the one who meets the Lizard Man. And so I guess you could say they kind of wrap that one up. At least Scully did. She figured it out. And then the other two episodes, things just kind of happened that they figured out what had happened, but didn't really, stop what had happened completely. But, some people said, the humor of this episode, the trip sequence was kind of... So this was written and directed by Chris Carter, and people said it's kind of similar to the postmodern Prometheus, or just because of how goofy it was. And I would kind of agree with that.
As much as I liked the trippy sequence, just because it was so wild, it went on a little bit too long, I think. At a certain point, I was like, all right, I enjoyed this. I like it. I want to jump back into the meat of things because I didn't want to keep, I feel like it started burning running time by that point. I'm like, oh man, I want to get back to kind of the drama,
Well, and two, this episode had a lot of different tone shifts. It tonally shifted multiple times. From the kind of seriousness of the cold open to, so there's tension as the new agents meet the old agents and then they pair off. And, then there's, like we said, there's racism stuff that's brought up and characters being, Islamophobic and things like that. And then it goes this, kind of balls to the wall trip scene.
Mm-hmm.
And then it kind of brings things back to the end and concludes the case and then has the kind of, the romantic side between Mulder and Scully and kind of delves into their relationship. So I wish that there had been a little bit more of a narrative through line throughout these episodes. I mean, we still have one more to go, but it just seems they kind of have that first episode to kick things off and bring the agents back together, get them back in the FBI. Then they kind of go off on a number of Monster of the Week cases and then come back to the conspiracy stuff. So, I mean, and this last episode, I believe it's just a normal hour episode. So
I hope it's a really good one because, again, I mentioned this before. Even watching this episode, I was like, man, I wish this run was longer, Because even though it's they're not all perfect, I'm just thoroughly enjoying them. I did go back and rewatch the first three episodes, and episode one feels very clunky to me now.
Yeah,
I was kind of fine with it. And I said at the time, I haven't watched all the X-Files episodes. I watched it when I was younger, when it was on, and I was like, oh, this is fine for me. And it was still fine. I still enjoyed it. But there was quite a few things that kind of stood out. But the second episode was still pretty good. And the third episode was, great.
I mean,
what was the second one?
The second one was Founder's Mutation, where there were the baby mutant kids, pretty much, or at least, not derogatorily, just the kids at the end that were the doctor's kids were kind of like X-Men, really, mm-hmm. with the powers they had. So, this episode, like I said, was written and directed by Chris Carter. The last episode, My Struggle 2, which comes out next week, is the only episode that has more than one credited writer, which is interesting because it's Chris Carter and then a couple of other people. So these have all, the first five have all just kind of been one writer's vision for the show. I'm not really sure how much direction they got from Fox, but I do think they kind of missed the chance to tie all these stories more into how the world operates today. Because the first episode kind of touch on like the almost like Glenn Beck style conspiracy theorist, crazy nut job web series type news personality. So I think that's kind of what they were going for. And, so, you know, that kind of made it like, you know, tied into the modern times. Mulder and Scully meet the weremonster, and Mulder commented on how, you know, in this day and age of all these phones, there's not any good pictures or footage of any of these supernatural occurrences.
Yeah.
And he talked about how a lot of the cases have been debunked that were from the original run of the X-Files. Or not that were on the show, but just from that era.
Yes.
And then some of these other ones like Home Again, Babylon, Founder's Mutation. It doesn't really seem like they tackled how, you know, in the modern day world, how everybody's got all these conspiracy theories and everybody's paranoid and the government did in fact spy on everyone through all the stuff that James Snowden leaked. Or Edward Snowden, not James.
Yeah,
Snowden.
I was like, James? Wait, what's
his
name?
Yeah, that's a new character I'm writing for Threat Level of the Night. Yeah, Edward Snowden leaked about all the NSA spying stuff. So the government has spied on people, which you think would be ripe for... I mean, they did kind of touch that on a little bit in the first episode, My Struggle. But you would think that they would kind of filter that more through the rest of the episodes.
Because
some of these, like Founder's Mutation, Home Again, those felt like they could have been the original run of the series, pretty much. If those had happened like in season 7 before Mulder left, like I think those would have just fit in there fine.
Yeah.
So it'd be nice to see a little bit more updating of the series to kind of account for, you know, modern times. Like they haven't really touched on social media or anything. It's usually kind of like a risky proposition because it can be terribly handled in shows. So sometimes it's better just not even do it. But you would think, you know, in the day and age of everybody claiming that every school shooting is a false flag operation and that all this stuff is fake, they could have, you know, filtered a little bit more of that. They did mention the word false flag in My Struggle, so they at least acknowledged it. But it's just overall, I mean, none of the episodes have been terrible. I enjoyed them all. I'll need to kind of rewatch them all again once the run is done to kind of reframe how I feel about them. But with Babylon, I feel that, you know, it's a perfectly serviceable episode. It doesn't stand amongst, like, any of the series' best. But, you know, it kind of gave more... At the end, I really liked the Mulder-Scully stuff towards the end of the episode.
Yes, yeah. That was well handled, I thought. Even though it was a cliche song being played.
Yeah.
I still enjoyed it.
But you knew exactly when that song played, when Mulder's sitting there by himself. It's like, okay, well, Scully's going to get there, and they're going to have some type of moment.
Yeah.
There's no reason to play that song and to pay the rights fee if you're not going to. And let's see if there's anything else I kind of wanted to cover. And then at the end of the episode, Mulder hears phantom trumpets.
Mm-hmm.
And then it zooms out to the globe, so I really wasn't sure where that was going. And then he talks about mothers can fix everything or something along those lines. It's like, that's kind of a weird statement, but I'm definitely excited to see how the next episode goes and see how it kind of ties all this these six episodes together. I mean, in the ratings, it's done pretty well, so I think there's motivation to do something else with the series, whether it be, you know, another limited run like this, or maybe a movie.
Do you have any bets that they'll make the announcement after next week's episode? Or do you think it'll be a little while?
I think it might be a while, because I think the biggest impediment is how busy Julian Anderson and David Duchovny are.
Yeah.
Because they both are on other shows and then have other projects going on. So I think they've even said, like, they liked doing this, but neither one of them had a desire to do another 22-episode season.
Yes, yeah.
And I think
I can see that, kind of.
Rolling it out in a limited fashion kind of builds it up to an event-type situation, so that can kind of lead to people being more into it.
Yeah.
But it doesn't give the network a long run of shows to bank on ratings for. So I'll be interested to see what they announce or when they announce it. Like, because I know, like you said, we said before, Chris Carter's written a third movie. like based on how the last one did at theaters, though, I'm not sure how willing they are to go back to that. But we will see. So, yeah. Do you have any other thoughts on this episode before we close it up?
No. Like I said, I thought it was pretty well paced. Yeah, maybe some of the issues weren't handled the best way, or to their full potential. You know, the things that could have been done with it, like you mentioned, some of this stuff has been missed opportunities. But just as purely entertainment, I liked it.
Yeah.
And I'm really looking forward to the next episode.
Yeah, I mean, I enjoyed it. I did, you know, have a few chuckles during the mm-hmm. trip sequence, just, you know, seeing David Duchovny in honky-tonk attire.
Yes,
yeah. And what was in the middle of, like, a really bad country music video.
I like that it builds to it, too, because Einstein's like, oh, you know, my partner, and they're like, your partner's not in there. And she's like, what? And then it just slowly, you know, first he's gone in the hall, then he's in the middle of the road, and then he's in that bar. Like, I love the way that whole builds and it plays out. Then it goes into kind of even the more of a, you know, more of a fantasy dream sequence or whatever. I know it's not technically a dream sequence, but I guess a deeper trip that is on another plane almost. But yeah, I love the way that built. It just kind of, I was like, all right, I want to get back to this story because, yeah, this did jump back and forth between different tones and the humor and drama. But that was one part when I was kind of ready to get back to the story. But other than that, again, yeah, I like this episode. I just hope that last one is satisfying. But there's been some good ones, you know?
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely, this isn't a disaster or failure. All the episodes have been enjoyable and mm-hmm. have added something. We just kind of have to see how it wraps up to kind of get an overall impression of how this season was and how necessary it was. But, you know, it's always good to see Duchovny and Gillian Anderson back on screen together because they do work pretty well in this series. So,
yeah, phenomenal chemistry.
So that'll bring this bonus episode of the House by Video Store podcast to a close. Thanks for listening.